Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Vegan Spirituality Online Gathering. This is part of In Defense of Animals Sustainable Activism Campaign, and my name is Lisa Levinson. I'm one of your co-hosts today, and I'm the director of the Sustainable Activism Campaign for IDA, and we offer these emotional and spiritual tools for activists and for vegans. And this whole vegan spirituality project is really started to explore veganism as a spiritual practice. And we do that through in-person groups that meet around the country. And if you'd like to find out about those, you can visit veganspirituality.com. And we also started this online gathering so we could reach folks who may not be in a city where there's an in-person gathering. And so we do this each month, and we're so excited that all of you could join us today. And my co-host is Judy Carmen. So I'll be the technical guide today behind the scenes, and Judy will be introducing our special guest today, John Pierre. She'll share more about him and more about herself in just a moment. So Judy, if you're ready, I'll turn it over to you.
All right. Thank you, Lisa. And hi, everybody, and welcome to our Vegan Spirituality Online Gathering. If I look bundled up to you, it's because I'm in Kansas and it's really cold here. But I want to introduce our special guest, John Pierre, JP, and we're so excited to have him on our show. He has so much experience and so much to share that we're really excited to hear what he has to say. Would take a book to introduce him, but I'm going to kind of shorten it. He is a nutrition and fitness consultant who has devoted more than a quarter century to helping and improving the lives of others through his expertise in geriatrics, nutrition, fitness, women's empowerment, green living, and cognitive retainment and improvement. He's sometimes referred to as the trainer to the stars because he has trained celebrities, rock stars, and Fortune 500 executives. John has a wide range of clientele, including military personnel and even hardcore athletes. He's a sought-after speaker at numerous vegetarian, animal rights, fitness, and health-promoting conferences around the world. So we are so lucky to have him join us. As a pioneer in the area of geriatrics, JP was one of the first to create classes on preventing falls and helped establish the link between diet and balance abilities. We could talk, obviously, for years with you, JP, but we are going to focus on vegan spirituality. His recent book, The Pillars of Health, was chosen by Dr. Neil Bernard, president of PCRM, the Physicians Committee for Responsible Medicine, as a favorite reading choice. His volunteer work also includes coordinating the collection and distribution of clothing and food to women's shelters, volunteering in animal shelters, and I think sanctuaries as well, and teaching comprehensive women's safety and empowerment seminars. He's also lectured at orphanages, teen runaway centers, and learning institutions with the goal of spreading the message about plant-based eating, nutrition, peace, and a compassionate lifestyle. So he has spoken to places where we would all love to have those people hear this message. So, and this contributes his speaking to increase levels of health for people, animals, and the environment. But one of the big things we want to talk about tonight is his lifelong dream of building a sanctuary and retreat center for homeless and neglected animals and women and young girls who are recovering from abuse. You can find out more about this dream at the website livingwithharmony.org. And I think Lisa might put that in the chat box, maybe. And more about John at johnpierre.com. And you can also get his newsletter. by going to the website. And I highly recommend that. So with no further delay, JP, I would like to start asking you some questions and getting you sharing with us. To start out, would you tell us how you became vegan and decided to dedicate your life to help both people and animals?
Sure. Well, thank you for having me. And yes, I became vegan about 30 years ago, and I was basically in around high school. And I had just been doing a lot of reading back then. IDA was just getting started. It was about 1983. So there wasn't a lot of periodicals. Obviously, there wasn't the internet, but there was some animal rights type magazines. And there wasn't much information on vegan diets or plant-based eating, but there was a few books on them. So for me, once I understood that the way I was getting my food, animals were dying for that, then it was an instant, immediate change. So, I couldn't believe it took me till high school to figure it out, but that's how the industries are. They kind of are so deceptive, and they make you think that there's hamburger patches and everybody's all happy. So that's kind of how I started. And, as I saw the atrocities that took place with the environment and animals, and of course people that were suffering too, I've done a lot of work with the homeless and battered women. That's just what I've done for 30 years. So really nothing has changed since I was in high school. I'm doing the same work. It's just that I'm doing more lecturing around the country and Canada and so forth.
Wow. That's amazing that you started so young. So many of us take a little longer than that to get the whole idea. So you've been dedicating your life, basically your whole life, to this.
Well, since high school. Mm-hmm. Yeah, since high school. I used to take the I'm from Chicago, so I used to take the L downtown with bags of food that I'd made, peanut butter and jelly sandwiches and thermoses of tea and little duffel bags of clothing, and I would deliver that to the homeless people. So I was doing all this stuff starting in high school. So really nothing has changed. Actually, the two oral reports I did in high school were animal rights was one lecture and the other was women's empowerment.
Wow. Oh, my gosh. Your teachers must have thought you were a very special child. So how would you describe your spiritual practice? And do you see your veganism as part of that practice?
Well, sure. I think it's important to differentiate today, especially the word plant-based and vegan. Plant-based just denotes a diet, and vegan denotes an entire lifestyle. So once that you're really, in the truest sense, vegan or following an ahimsa path, which is compassion and reverence for all beings, well, of course you'll be vegan then, and of course you'd be loving and kind. You wouldn't have any prejudice. You wouldn't be a speciesist. So you wouldn't just protect dogs and cats and then go ride horses or go to rodeos. So you have reverence for all animals. So I think veganism becomes like a religion for many people. And I'm for all religions that teach love and compassion. As long as they're teaching love and kindness and practicing that, I think that's important. But I've been on a lot of spiritual radio shows and so forth. And the people talk a lot about spiritualism and compassion and love. But three times a day, they commit acts of violence called breakfast, lunch, and dinner. So I think we need to look at our lifestyle. You just can't go to church, or you just can't say some prayers, or you can't just write a check to a charity and all of a sudden you're spiritual and kind and loving. You may be spiritual, but I think you need to look a little bit deeper in terms of who you're kind to.
Mm-hmm. So does that seem to affect people when you're on those shows and they haven't thought about being vegan? And then they
People get affected. They get offended. I don't say it in an offensive way. I just say that we need to, we're speciesists if we're just loving, like one group. And I think that like when I've worked with abused women for 30 years. So when I do lectures to women and teaching empowerment and safety, and then I'm talking about what happens in the dairy industry, that this poor cow is getting sexually assaulted. And then her baby is getting taken away from her. All of a sudden now people start thinking a little bit different. They start relating more to the animal and understand when you start explaining it that this is sexual assault. This is not with their permission.
Yeah.
So I think it's just important that people understand that.
Right. Yeah. So you're basically saying veganism and spirituality go hand in hand. And
ahimsa. I think that's important because I think when you're following veganism through its truest sense, you're practicing ahimsa, which is just the Sanskrit word for compassion or reverence for all beings.
Right.
And we're the beings. We're beings, and then all of our all human races beings and all animals and insects.
Right.
And I just try to practice the compassion or reverence as much as I can. I try to do as little damage as possible. And that includes the words that I use and the images that I allow into my life. And that's why I'm not really pro. I think TV is okay, but I think it's a lot of violence and a lot of negative programming. Same thing with a lot of music. And, you know, I was speaking at the Capitol for like 150 congressional people, and I was talking about that, the link between diet and children's violence today, and also what they're listening to. They're 12 years old, and they're watching triple X pornography. They're listening to gangster rap, and they're playing violent video games. So those are all forms of violence that we take into our being, and they become us eventually.
Right, along with the violent food that they've been eating.
Of course. Absolutely.
It all works together. So would you say you started out so young, this may be a difficult question to answer, but would you say that your veganism has helped you spiritually, or has your spirituality helped you with your vegan activism, which can be difficult, as you know, because you do get negative feedback from people often, and a lot of people who still don't see the value of ahimsa. So does your spirituality help you deal with that?
Well, yes, but I don't use the word deal with it because I'm not really dealing with it. That's their energy, that's their opinion, that's their experiences. So I don't make a judgment on them because I wasn't born vegan. So when I'm working with a client one-on-one, they may say to me, I have no intention of being vegan. Well, that doesn't offend me because I know that's where they're at now. I'm sure if you would have told me about veganism when I was five, I wouldn't quite understand it. So I'm not really dealing with it. I just accept it, that when I need a client, this is where they're at. Mm-hmm. My job is to give them as much love and kindness and compassion and education and information so they can just make that educated choice.
Right. I understand what you're saying. I think what I was getting at was activists who are confronted with the cruelty so much, you know, for example, watching Earthlings, mm-hmm. you know, or showing it to a lot of people. It's very traumatic to watch it, see it, know about it, know that it's happening, even if you're not watching it. And I think a lot of the purpose of our vegan spirituality group is to help people who come to us and listen to these conference calls to cope with that angst and that despair that can come to us from facing all this and knowing what's going on with SeaWorld and zoos and in slaughterhouses and all of that. So I understand what you're saying about one-on-one and meeting people where they are, but what about just coping in your own heart with the atrocities that we know are going on?
Well, sure. I just choose to focus my camera on solutions and not problems. So I know what's out there, so I understand it. But, you know, the only thing worse than evil is watching evil take place and doing nothing. So I chose at a young age to acknowledge what was there, but not just to watch. I actually took action. So I devoted my life to trying to make changes as an educator. And, you know, I work a lot with people, whether they're athletes or executives or law enforcement, that are very, very high levels of stress. And activists are under a lot of stress. But the worst thing an activist can do to bring their cortisol levels up like crazy is to watch more stressful things. So most of the time when I'm working with a client that's an activist, I'm having them disassociate with that and just work on solutions. We know it exists, but what are you going to do about it?
Mm-hmm. Okay. And that helps you. Yeah. And
I don't choose, you know, your mind is like a fertile garden. So what you plant, it grows. So I don't choose to be exposed to negative energies and negative thoughts and negative images. You know, so I just don't even see that. I've trained, obviously, Sean, who did Earthlings. I was just on the phone with him today. And, you know, I've trained him and I've trained the staff from, you know, his whole team. And, you know, Sean would have to sit in front of a computer watching negative images for 12 hours a day. And so I was working with him. So I had to make sure that he had an outlet, you know, via exercise and positive thoughts. But it's not healthy for you to subject yourself to that all the time. You have to have an outlet. You have to have some diversion. And if you go and do pickets or protests, that's at least an outlet for you getting together with people that are like-minded and you're actually doing something instead of just sitting at home thinking about the problem and doing nothing.
Uh-huh. Okay. That's great advice. I think that we'll all take that to heart. Okay, I've got another question. Your work is so inspiring, and all your actions reveal so much compassion that you have for others. And it's said that the more compassion we have in our hearts, the happier we are. Would you agree with that?
I guess, sure.
You would.
Yeah, of course. And again, I'm focusing my camera on positive things all the time. So if you're focusing on negative, you're having your direction, you'd be depressed and sad. But if you're focusing on solutions and acknowledging the good that you did. So, for instance, when I was a kid, before I would go to bed, I would bullet point all the positive things I did for the animals and humanity today. And, you know, list 10 or 12. And then that would validate to me as a child, a young, you know, youngster, what good I did. But then right before I went to bed, I'd ask the most important question is, what good can I do tomorrow? So all day long, you know, I'm doing positive. Before I go to bed, I'm acknowledging the positive, and then I'm programming myself to what positive am I going to do tomorrow.
Wow. That sounds like a very good practice that everybody that's listening could do, because I know everybody that's listening is doing good things and positive mm-hmm. things to make a difference.
Sure, and you have to acknowledge it and validate yourself. I mean, just like we tell other people that they did a good job and acknowledge it, we also mm-hmm. acknowledge when we do good, too. There's nothing wrong with that. Yeah, that's a lot of people say, well, isn't that bragging? It's like, well, yeah, you should be bragging, because there's other people in the world that are doing bad things, and we're doing good things, so we should be proud of it. We should acknowledge that, you know? Yeah. Sometimes doing the right thing Absolutely. Is not always easy in our society.
Yeah.
But it's something you need to train. Because what I wrote about in the Pillars of Health, my first book, I wrote about when I was a kid, and I would go to a store and whatever I was buying, I don't know, candy, and I'd get a couple blocks away when I was walking, and I'd look at, and I had too much change. So I'd go back, and I told the cashier I got too much change. So as a young age, I was always, you know, when something needed correcting, and I needed to be honest and fair, I did it. And it just makes it easier and easier the more you practice it. But if you practice deception, yeah. every time you practice deception or doing something wrong, it just becomes easier to do that again tomorrow. And then before you know it, you dance with the devil, and there's no getting out.
Yeah.
So I think the idea is to always focus on good, doing good.
Well, and creating solutions, and that is something we really wanted to ask you about, is this dream of yours that you want to create this sanctuary for abused women and animals, right? Farmed animals?
And laboratory animals.
And laboratory animals, okay. All right, tell us about that. It's so exciting.
Sure. So Living with Harmony, we're a 501c3, we're a nonprofit. And basically, Living with Harmony is what I've done for 30-something years. So it's working with animal rescue, promoting plant-based eating, promoting AHIMSA, working with abused women, and then teaching nutrition and fitness. So a retreat center with an animal sanctuary. And then I work with the teams, Project Child Save, .org, and they actually go in and they rescue children from sex trafficking. So I work very closely with them, and they're all volunteers. They're ex-military that go in and they rescue these children, and they risk their lives to get these kids out. So that's eventually, if we got the funding and we could build small houses on the property, we'd be able to help some of these kids, you know, intertwine with animals a little bit. So we still in need of funds and or somebody donating a property. So we're always asking if anyone has somebody donated a property to them or their grandparents left it and they're not using it, and there's a barn and a home and some land, you know, that would be something we could get going on. Because we have the staff. We have a vegan vet tech. I've got a vegan manager already that's on her fourth internship at another sanctuary. So we have our staff.
I read about that.
Yeah, and we're doing, you know, we're already doing the work. We're rescuing animals. We run a food pantry for the homeless and people who don't have a high income so their animals can get dog and cat food. So we're always doing something. We just don't have the land yet.
Yeah, and you, and it's going to be in Colorado, is that right?
It could be in Colorado, or if somebody donated, let's say, a property somewhere else, you know, we might be able to take that. Yeah, it's just, unfortunately, it's like any sanctuary or any nonprofit, it's all funding. And the sad part is that we don't have a lot of experience with fundraising and social media. That's just not our thing. You know, that's, I only know nutrition and fitness and compassion and what I've taught, so I'm not very good with social media. So we're trying to get volunteers still to help us.
Some fundraising volunteers.
Yeah, anything. So if anyone wants to help, they can email us at thelivingwithharmony.org, our site.
It's, could you say that again? I think it broke up a little bit.
Sure, it's
living in harmony.
Livingwithharmony.org.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So people can go to that website and see more details about what.
Yeah, we have a newsletter. We have a newsletter, and we just explain the work that we're doing. And I'm still lecturing across the country at all the, you know, the different vegetarian or animal rights conferences, still promoting plant-based eating and HIMSO. So I try to work a lot with activists and prevent burnout, because a lot of activists are really, they have their hearts in it, and they work so hard around the clock, and they also have a regular paying job, and then it's activism. Many of them burn out. So it's one of the things that plant-based eating is very important for them, that they're doing whole foods plant-based, not junk food vegan.
Right. Yes. That's a very good point. Yeah. So you help with that. So people can, how can they contact you for help?
Oh, sure. Yeah, well, you can go to the Living with Harmony site, or my email is foods, foodsforlifejp at yahoo.com.
Okay,
sure.
Wonderful. Wow. Well, you're just doing so much. And this is a lot of what we're about, is preventing burnout and keeping activists active.
Right.
Because we've got a long ways to go. We've still got a lot to do and a lot of hearts to change. And like you say, it can be difficult when you've got a job, or you're taking care of parents or children or whatever, and trying to be a full-time activist also, it can really wear you down. So, well, that is just amazing, and we wish you the very best with that, and hopefully someone will come along with some land.
I hope that
would be wonderful to see, yeah. So, I was going to ask you for advice on how to stay spiritually strong. I think you've addressed that quite a bit already. Is there anything you'd like to add to what you've already said about remaining strong, not burning out, hanging in there for the long run? It's one of those things where you almost have to let go of the outcome in order to stay in it, because the outcome could be so many years from now.
Yeah, I think you always have to remember, every day you're planting seeds and you may not see the good you're doing. I've done some conferences 7 years ago where one of the participants, you know, had some serious addictions and problems. So I pulled him to the side and spent a lot of time with him. And 7 years later, he wrote me and he said, you know, 7 years ago, I met you at a conference and you took all this time with me. And he goes, I want to let you know that my addiction is done now. I'm done with it. And I'm clean and sober. Uh-huh. And I thought, wow, 7 years ago, I mean, I remember who he was, but it must have really meant a lot to him that I did that. So we never know when we're planting seeds. And so our goal is really just to light as many candles as we can. And then hopefully they'll light other candles. And then the world will have lots of light instead of darkness.
Yeah, beautiful. Well, I'm going to open up for questions fairly soon here. Is there anything else you want to add?
I think it's important, just quickly from a plant-based perspective, to keep healthy. You want to make sure that you're getting as much plant matter as you can in your diet in terms of volume. So I think things like green smoothies and blended soups are an easy way to get a massive amount of fresh fruits and vegetables in your diet, especially for people who just don't like to eat a lot of fresh fruits and vegetables. So smoothies and blended soups are very important. And trying to stay away from processed foods, have it more as transitional food. So, you know, the vegan hot dogs and hamburgers, you're not supposed to be eating them every day. You're using them kind of transition from meat-based foods because they are very high in sodium and many are high in fat. And again, if you want to be a good activist, you want to be the best role model you can. And you also want to be able to be healthy so you can continue to be an activist. So you want to take care of yourself, get exercise in every day, sit as little as possible, and just try to keep moving. And then, of course, as I said, always keep your camera focused on positive things. You know, my mantra has always been think good thoughts and do good deeds. So just always focus on good and always try continually when you meet people to look for the good in them. No matter how evil you may believe they are, you still have to look for good because, you know, we were all born blank as a baby. So Hitler, Mother Teresa, Gandhi, they're all born blank. They have to get programmed by their friends and parents in society. So we really can't make a judgment on them. When you see a little child that's in the Ku Klux Klan, that's 8 years of age, you can't hate a child like that because he was programmed to be in the Klan. He doesn't even understand it. So our goal, I think, is to shed as much love and light on people as we can, not make a judgment and just be there to support them.
I think it's really great that you're helping women and animals, well, people and animals, because I think a lot of criticism that we get from people as animal activists is that we don't care about people. And you're a shining example of caring about both and really the whole concept of veganism and ahimsa is to do no harm and to do the most good to everyone, not just animals.
And so, and that includes ourselves.
And ourselves. And that, it's easy to forget that for sure, especially people with big hearts that, like our listeners, who tend to think about others and forget about themselves. It's really, really important. Like they say on the airplane, you have to put the oxygen mask on yourself first. Same kind of thing. Lisa, shall we open up for Q&A?
Sure, we'll go ahead and do that.
There she is. And there may be some comments on the chat room.
Yeah, so how we'll do this, I'm going to change the format a little bit of what everyone's seeing. So if you'd like to ask a question and you'd like to turn your video on, you're welcome to do that so that we can see one another. If you are wanting to, let's see, use the telephone, if you're on the phone with us, I think you can press *4 to be able to ask a question on the telephone. And then if you want to ask a question in the chat box, you can do that as well. You can even use your microphone, unmute your microphone, but keep your video off. So there's lots of different ways that you can ask a question. If you have any comment or question for JP, I know we've been chatting with him for a little while now, but there may be something that you'd like to ask. So feel free to do that. And meanwhile, I'll go ahead and change the layout here so we can see a few people. Great.
I see JP. Right.
Wonderful. Well, that's good news. So let's, we have, you know, just extend that in invitation to anyone else if they'd like to ask a question or something they'd like to share.
Lisa, are there any questions in the chat box?
I'm looking there. I don't see anything new. So it looks like, yeah, it looks pretty good with the questions there. And then in terms of everyone joining us, I just want to tell you, JP, just I am so impressed with your having this business that really promotes veganism, and then you also and taking care of yourself, and then you also have this whole other side, which is about what I consider to be altruism, and I think that's just so beautiful. And it's, to me, it's wonderful that you extend yourself to help others, and then you're really teaching others how to do that as well by showing, you know, through your actions. So I think that's really impressive, you know, to connect with people and with animals that way.
Yeah, it is. It's amazing. JP, I've got a question. If, let's say there are some parents out there who have children who are being overly influenced at school by the violent games and of course, the violent food and all that, how can they help their children become more altruistic? What's a good way to convey altruism, to get a child to want to be altruistic?
Well, I think you have to spend time with children, first of all, and I think that's one of the challenges. A lot of parents let their video games and music and things like that and computer time do the parenting. So I think we need to go back to the old way when people ate together, participated together, they sat and they made time together, and they connected together. So I think that's one of the challenges. The other thing is I think when you look at video games, I mean, you have to understand, when I originally had a client, I don't remember how many years ago, maybe 10 years ago, that told me about these violent video games, and there were secret chambers that you go in and you have sex with prostitutes. And they were telling me there's the video games where you shoot police officers and you get rewards. You run over cats and dogs. So you have to understand that children are being programmed from almost birth to be very violent and the opposite of altruistic, the opposite of sensitive, just utter violence and not even caring. When you watch TV today, you see people having affairs, people cheating, people using drugs. So children learn to believe that's normal. So as a parent, it's your responsibility to let your children know that isn't normal, that isn't healthy. You have to spend time educating them. And you also need to change your child's diet, because if your child is not getting the right nutrients, their neurotransmitters are not going to be firing correctly. And it's like if you have a lock and the combination is 5, 10, 12, and you put in 5, 10, 10, the lock's not going to open. And you're only off by two digits. Well, that's how the brain is. If you're only off by a couple nutrients, the brain doesn't work properly. So parents need to be very adamant about keeping the child's diet very healthy, keeping them away from media that influences them and ultimately is raising them.
I've read that meditation can help actually grow the part of the brain where empathy resides. And I wonder if that's something that a parent could do with their children, teach them meditation.
If you could imagine the average child not leaving, and they're literally have a ball and chain to their cell phone and their computer, so they're continually getting these dopamine blasts every time there's a ding on their phone. The last thing a child has ever done is meditated. So it's very difficult for children to not have any of that stimulation. So what I start with is I have families and children to get in the kitchen and start chopping food and taking your time. I'd like you to chop this banana. I'd like you to chop this apple, this celery. That to them is as much concentration as meditation as they may be able to withstand for right now. But you're correct, the meditation is one of the best things that we can do on a daily basis. And even if it's just closing your eyes and listening to some relaxing music, that's a start. Or before you eat a meal, saying grace, that's a start. So you have to kind of sneak it into a child's life. You can't just send them to a meditation camp where they're silent for 3 days.
Yeah, right. That'd be a little over the top.
Yeah, I'm wondering, some of the folks who joined us in the video, such as Sarah, Jean, if you have a question, you're welcome to ask that. You can unmute yourself. And I noticed also Frank, yeah, do you have a question?
Hi, Frank.
I do. Everyone, hello.
Hi, Frank.
Hello. How's everybody doing? JP, thank you for the great great seminar that you're giving. It's very, very nice, very moving. I wanted to ask you a question specifically. How do you deal with people that actually don't follow your ahimsa lifestyle? And I'm sure it's upsetting for you at times, but how do you deal with the emotion of that?
Well, again, I think that everyone's on their own path. And so as long as I've planted seeds and hopefully given them a different, you know, thought to something to think about, that's the best I can do for now. You know, we all get overly anxious and want to make people a natural convert. But Frank, if I was working with you, let's say one-on-one, and I said, Frank, you know, did you do your meditation this morning, your aromatherapy and your yoga? Did you do your stretching and your foam rolling and your exercise? And of course, did you journal and do your affirmations? You'd be like, what? So that's just so overwhelming for you to hear. And that's how I see it when I'm working with people. They're just overwhelmed at what I'm saying. Because since they've been born, they've been raised through their religion and their family that animals are put on this earth to serve us. Women are here to serve us is what they believe. And certain races are not supposed to be equal to a certain race. So they've been brainwashed to believe all these things. For years they've had their brainwashing. There's no way I'm going to change it in 1 hour meeting. But what I can do is at least plant some seeds, just like when I speak to women's groups and I talk about a cow being sexually assaulted and her baby stolen from them. That's enough that they come up to me and they said, JP, in all the years that I've heard about women's rights and everything, I've never once thought about a cow being sexually assaulted or her baby stolen. And that's so mind-blowing to them that that's the best I can hope for at that meeting. And then the other thing that I do is I may give them my book or I might give them some websites for Ahimsa and, you know, have them have some, you know, some classes, listen to some Mother Teresa or Leo Viscalia or Wayne Dyer or somebody who's teaching something about introspection. But maybe when I first started, when I was, you know, in high school, I would get frustrated that kids or other people weren't understanding that. But I think as time went on, I've come to realize that everyone's at their own place. And I can't try to force them or rush them to be ready.
Oh, that's great. That's terrific. How do you deal with the violence or the anti-ahimsa aspect of people? How do you deal with the vehemence against veganism per se?
Well, it depends what, you know, I try to meet people where they're at. So if somebody, if I'm working with a client that is just interested in performance, then I'm going to promote, you know, plant-based eating to help them perform better. So I kind of try to reach them and give them, if somebody's, you know, has heart disease or erectile dysfunction, I'm going to let them know how a plant-based diet can eradicate that. And it's just about education. I don't really get upset. Because if I got upset about it, it wouldn't be ahimsa anyhow, so it's not in my being. You know, when you squeeze an orange, what comes out is orange juice, because that's what's in the orange, not apple juice. So if you're stressed and you get metaphorically squeezed and you become angry and violent, well, that's who you really are. So you need to take a look at yourself then if you have that anger and violence. So if somebody is not very friendly or nice to me, actually the thing that I'm most drawn to do is to give them more love and compassion. Because if somebody has heart disease, you don't give them the disease. You don't give them saturated fat and cholesterol and salt and sugar. You give them the antidote. So if you're mean to me, the antidote is being compassionate and more loving to you, not angry and hostile.
Great. Thank you.
That's beautiful. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you, JP. I really appreciate that metaphor with this, what you squeeze is what's inside comes out, because that's something that all of us need to look at, especially. I mean, part of this whole journey is self-reflection and then bringing the love that we have for ourselves once we learn to not judge ourselves and forgive ourselves. And then we can extend that to others and offer more to the animals as well. So thank you for that. It's a really powerful image.
And I also think it's very important that we walk our talk in life. So don't say something about yourself that's not true. You know, I've worked a lot with people who have hired me that were very high up in the so-called spiritual world and yogis. And when you see them on stage, they're one persona. And when you get into their house, when I've gone into their home and they're fighting with their kids and husbands and, you know, using, you know, languages you would never expect, they're not really walking their talk. So then I have to confront them on that and say, you know, out in the world, you're portraying this image, and here behind closed doors, you're something different. That's not being authentic. And I think it's very important that we walk our talk and be honest, because, you know, if you're not, then you're never going to be able to help people, because it's, again, the orange is being squeezed. You're really violent and angry, and you're really not going to be able to help people, and especially children. Children are hypersensitive. They can feel your energy. So when parents are not walking their talk, the child can feel that amongst their parents.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's so true. Children are so sensitive.
Sure.
They're
yeah,
a lot,
they learn.
A lot, the little ones are a lot like dogs. They can tell. And cats. They can tell
yeah.
if you're not being honest.
Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with just telling people, you know, I'm not at that level yet. I'm not ready. But you don't have to lie and pretend you are that level when you're not.
Mm-hmm.
That's hurting you and it's hurting other people, especially in the plant-based movement. If you're promoting eating a particular diet on the stage and then behind closed doors you're not eating it, or if you're in the spiritual world and you're promoting love and compassion and you're not really loving. And a lot of people, I'll be frank with you, when I teach in the spiritual community, they close up when I start talking about veganism, and they get very angry about it. And it's like, well, you can define your spirituality any way you want, but please don't tell the world that you're loving and compassionate when you're paying somebody to butcher and brutalize an animal. Acknowledge that you're doing that. You're paying somebody. Just like if somebody paid a hitman to hurt somebody and that hitman got caught, well, you're responsible because you paid that hitman. So you didn't dirty your hands, but you're responsible. So take responsibility for that. And I think in the spiritual so-called world, many of these people out there are not really walking their talk. I don't think it's fair to people to follow the guru, and the guru is not really walking their talk. They're leading these people astray.
Yeah.
Well, that's so key. I really appreciate that you mentioned that, because it's part of why we started the vegan spirituality group, was that contradiction, going to a lot of spiritual events and then finding that there was, meat eating going on. There were things happening that weren't conveying that message of peace to all beings. So it's really key to kind of challenge some of the notion of spirituality and have that include our own actions as well. I think it's very courageous of you to do that with people that you're working with, and I think that is something really of value.
Well, I think when I do it, I think many times they use the term like, well, JP, you just called me on this. You know, no one else has called me on it. And I was like, well, don't you want to be authentic? Don't you want to be who you are? I'm not making a judgment, but I'm just saying that don't tell the world how loving and compassionate you are if you're a speciesist and you're just being loving to one group, you know, but you're not being loving to the other. So you're also a racist. So that's a problem. That's not compassionate and that's not loving. And I don't think being a compassionate, loving person means that we can't confront people. You know, that's the other problem. Everyone thinks when you're compassionate, loving in ahimsa, you just sit by and let all the damage take place and say nothing. No, I don't think that at all. Because again, watching evil take place and doing nothing about it is worse than evil. Because you know evil's happening and you're not doing anything about it. That's the worst
thing.
So I just think people need to be loving to themselves. They need to be authentic and just tell people, you know, I'm not at that level yet. It's like when I work with clients, I'm not trying to talk to them the first day about honey. It's just like, why would I talk about honey when they're not ready to hear about honey yet? You know, I'm not going to be fighting for ants' rights when they're at the rodeo and the circus and the zoo. They're not going to understand that. So I think you have to meet people where they're at. But when I meet the vegan community and people who practice ahimsa, then I might start talking about more about how the media affects you, or how music affects you, or how words affect you. You know, so I think you have to meet people where they're at and not judge people. When I meet people who are mean and angry, honestly, I'm not offended or hurt by them, because I know that where they're at is just where they're at. You know, when I was 10, you know, I did things like went fishing or whatever, and I loved fish. So that's the reason I went fishing. I had no idea I was hurting the fish. If somebody would have stopped me and said to me, you know, you're hurting the fish, I would have ran away crying. So I don't think I'm any better than anyone else, so I don't judge anyone at all.
I think another good thing about vegan spirituality and getting together like this and learning ways of finding more inner peace for ourselves is that then we can get to that point that you're talking about, JP, where we can actually have so much joy within ourselves that other people go, wow, maybe it's not so bad to be an animal activist or vegan. Because there has been, as we know, this perception of us as angry, you know, protesters throwing paint on coats and that sort of thing. And at this point in our development, I think it's time for us to show the world that this is a beautiful, peaceful way to live. And but we need to work on ourselves to be able to do that. So, sure. And that's what you're talking about. So, yeah.
Yeah, and there is a lot of animal activists who are very angry and mean, and they're throwing paintballs and, you know, people wearing furs and things like that. And I just don't think that's, you're not educating anyone. I understand why you do it, because you're upset and frustrated, right. But you're not really educating somebody. And I'm more interested, actually, in just giving people information. And if they choose to change, wonderful, but I'm not going to try to force them to change. That's not my right. It would be like me telling you the best shoe in the world is a men's size 9. Well, that's not best for you. So I'm going to let you decide what's best for you. Mm-hmm. But I just at least want to give them information, because a lot of people don't, like I did when I was a kid, I didn't realize that this hamburger was once a living, breathing being. I had no idea. I didn't understand that this milk that I thought came from a cow happily is a product of torture and abuse. And once I found that out, I immediately stopped consuming it. It wasn't a challenge at all for me. People say to me all the time, do you miss animal products or dairy products? And I say, no more than you miss robbing or hurting your neighbor. It's not part of who you are. I don't miss abuse and torture. I'm sorry that I had those products when I was a kid. I didn't know any better.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and so many people are in that spot now. And I think if they can see that we're not only happy with the choices we've made and with the lifestyle that we've, of harmlessness that we've chosen, that they'll be more attracted to it.
Absolutely. I think you're right about that. People need to understand it's a beautiful thing. It's not something that we're eating celery and carrot sticks all day and we're not happy with our life, you know, like the food isn't good tasting and everything. So, you're right. And that's one of the reasons, too, that I do give a lot of food away, especially processed vegan food, when I meet people, because I want to help them understand that the veggie burgers and the veggie hot dogs taste very similar to regular hamburgers and hot dogs. And then they start liking it, the vegan cheeses and look so delicious, the different almond milks and coconut milks and things. So, sometimes you have to really go out your way and every time you go to a family gathering or any time anyone invites you somewhere, it's important to bring a really, really nice vegan dish.
Yeah.
And because people want something tasty. They don't want just salad and carrots.
Right. Yeah. Because they have that perception of us as being aesthetic and starving ourselves or you know, missing all of this food that we used to eat. So, they need to see, this is even better. Yeah.
I see somebody else on the screen. Is it Sarah Jean?
Yes, that's me.
Hi. Did you have any questions?
Not necessarily. I'm actually new in the vegan world, about 6 months or so. Vegetarian of 15 years, but the vegan is new. But I actually was orphanon, vegetarian, vegan, actually as a child, as I tried to stop at age 5. You know, the big brothers telling me exactly what I was eating at the table, and I threw it at my dog and said I'm never eating it again. But at the age of 5, you know, it's a little harder when you have, you know, four other brothers and siblings, you know, and family. You know, they tried to help me as much as they could. And when I got home, I ate vegetarian food. And then when I was out with my, you know, friends, I didn't think anything other, you know, than meat, because I was 5 years old. But at age 5, I was in and out of, you know, not eating meat and stuff like that. So I started pretty early, and I was very adamant about not eating meat and stuff like that. But the vegan is definitely new to me, so I'm just trying to meet others and listen to everyone else's story.
Oh, good. Well, you came to the right place. Judy and Lisa have a great thing going here.
But yeah, so I'm excited to hear your story. Your stories are great, and it's helping, because I see a lot of stuff out there that I'm, you know, I try to talk to people. I'm not here to completely preach to anybody, as everyone takes their own time. But it is hard to see certain things, especially on social media. where, you know, half the people that that are on my social media accounts, whether I know them personally or not, you know, liking certain things and thinking pictures are cute, but all they do is go home and eat that particular animal, you know, at nighttime. Mm-hmm. And it's just irritating because it's contradictory, you know. Don't like and comment and say something so cute, but then hours later go home and eat the exact same thing.
So it's Earthlings would be a very, very powerful video for them to see. Even Cowspiracy, that's very gentle, but I think that has a great message in it too. And in terms of dairy, I think actually the scariest thing I've seen is on YouTube. You can look it up. I think it's Conklin Dairy, and I think it's spelled with a C, C-O-N-K-L-I-N. It's about a 3-minute video clip of supposedly a family of dairy farmers. It's like a family, and you can barely get through 30 seconds of it when you look at that abuse. And I think anybody who sees that and sees what's happening to these poor animals, and this is supposed to be a good family farm, I don't think anybody with a beating heart would ever be able to drink or eat dairy products again. Very sad.
I actually am working with Earthling coming up, which is really nice.
You're working with who?
Oh, what do you call it? Is it called Earthlings?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I'm actually going to be, but I'll be meeting with them in about a week or so. And I'm doing some discussions and then doing an activist in St. Petersburg in Florida. So,
oh, great. Okay.
So I'm a little excited about that.
Hey.
Yep.
Wonderful. That's great. Who is that you're petting?
This is my service dog. It's my Siberian Husky and Australian Shepherd dog passed out.
Wow.
Yeah, it's getting her love in before she goes to sleep, which she's pretty much doing right now.
She is.
She's knocked out.
She's adorable.
Thank you.
Oh, boy.
Well, thank you so much, Sarah Jean, for sharing your story with us. That's really neat to hear your journey and just to know that, you know, you're part of our community. We're all from the same, you know, heart, really. And just so that you know that you're connected to us and you can tune in anytime to be part of the community. We have these events. We actually host an event the first and second and fourth Thursdays of the month, and we even have an activist support group that meets on the fourth Thursday at the same time. So definitely, you know, stay connected, because I think that's what's so key for activists, is to have an opportunity to talk amongst each other so that we can get the support that we need, so we can share the stories, and it gives us all a little bit more, just more resources, more speaking with other people out there. So thank you for joining us.
And thank you for having me. It's great.
Yeah, thanks.
So I'm just checking in to see if anyone else has any other questions or comments they'd like to share. We have just a few minutes left of our online gathering. So if anybody who hasn't spoken up yet, maybe, or somebody wants to say in the chat box, feel free to do that. Let's see.
Really, really fun to see people up on the screen too.
yeah, it's great. We love this online forum to be able to really connect in a little bit more real ways here with our faces and also with the chatting. So if anybody else is out there and wants to join in this conversation, that would be fine. Of course, we appreciate everyone listening too, because sometimes, you know, you might be in another situation where it's not so easy to talk. But we welcome your voices. And
Jake, is there somebody? So I've got a question.
Sure, go for it. Yeah.
Okay. JP, I have been out to Gentle Barn in California. Have you been to that wonderful place?
Ellie and Jay,
aren't
they're wonderful.
Amazing? Yeah, wonderful. And they help children at risk, mm-hmm. right?
Right, absolutely.
So they get to connect with the animals. And it's got to be extremely healing for them. And it sounds similar to what you're going to do, only you're expanding that even further to abused women and making it even more far-reaching.
Well, when you were talking about meditation, aside from getting children to take their time and, you know, chop up vegetables and things, being around animals is like a type of meditation for children too. It gives them that time to put their cell phone away and just connect with an animal. It's that little bit of quiet time that they so desperately need. And the more they do it, the more their anxiety and stress goes down. And so that's one of the ways kids actually heal who have attention deficit and hyperactivity is actually being around animals, because it's very soothing to them, because they feel that energy from the animal and they don't feel the energy from an electronic device, which is very excitatory and stressful.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah. It's so true. Dogs and cats, just petting, just touching them. And in their case at Gentle Barn, there's farmed animals too.
Right.
That they can relate to, and an animal, there's something about them that even though they're not saying words, human words to us, there's that love that just comes through.
Mm-hmm.
And just the soul gazing with their eyes and all of that, it's just a wonderful idea, I think, to connect children with animals.
Yeah, it's a natural Prozac for many of these kids who have attention deficit and hyperactivity.
Yeah.
And I've worked with so many of those kids. It's amazing when you change their diet and change their music and change their entertainment, how it changes their moods. It's amazing.
Mm-hmm.
I had kids that have been to 9 psychiatrists, 6 psychologists, every medication under the sun, and then experimental meds for attention deficit and violence. Nothing happened. And they brought them to me. Once I put them on a plant-based diet, got them some brain nutrients like B12 and DHA, got rid of the music they were listening to and no video games, they popped back to normal, and nobody could believe it.
Wow.
That's how powerful the lifestyle changes are. It's the lifestyle.
Uh-huh.
And that's why the media and cell phones and computers are, they're very alluring to people, especially when you're raised that way. You don't know any better, but they're very dangerous. They lead you down a portal that is leads you away from introspection. So the less time that you spend on your computer and your your phones, the less time you have to work on yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And no child today really does inner work. They're not really doing inner work. Everything is just computerized stuff.
Right.
So I think we all need to take a media break.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. And children especially, because their brains are so flexible and so sensitive at that age, and they don't know how to process all that stuff.
Exactly. Well, think about a child that still believes in Santa Claus is watching triple X pornography. I mean, that makes no sense at all. They don't understand that. And then, you know, part of what I talk about in my second book is called Strong, Savvy, Safe, which is the women's guide to empowerment and safety. But one of the things that I talk about in there is that when you, as a woman, are born as a child, you're given a Barbie doll and an Easy Bake Oven. And me being a boy, and I'm given a slingshot and a G.I. Joe, you know, with a kung fu grip.
Right.
So our roles are starting to get established at infancy. You're dressed in pink, I'm dressed in blue. If I fall down, I'm told not to cry. So we start getting brainwashed and programmed at birth, actually.
Yeah. It's still happening in it, and it's especially for boys. There's a new kind of trend with girls, this American Girl doll.
I've heard
fad, I guess you could call it. Each doll has a story, and some of the dolls are activists.
Oh, wow.
Or athletes, or they've saved someone. They all have a story. It's a real healthy relationship kind of stuff. So there are some good things happening.
Sure.
But for the boys, it's rough. It really
It sure is, because all these kids play video games and watch mixed martial arts, and it's all about violence, so that's the problem.
Yeah, right. Well, JP, we are close to out of time. Have you got a closing thought or prayer that you would like to offer? Go, Lisa. What?
Oh, no, I was going to say, actually, if you'd be open to leading that tonight, that would be great. The
me?
Prayer.
Okay. Okay. Well, What I will ask everybody to do is what Will Tuttle and I have a website called circleofcompassion.org, and on that website we have a prayer which we have about almost 1,000 people now saying this prayer every day at noon, and you can sign up for that prayer, to say that prayer, to agree to say that prayer, on the website, circleofcompassion.org. And I'm going to say that prayer in just a minute. It's really beautiful, and it is gaining in power because it is being repeated so often by so many people. And it has also been translated into, I think we've got it in about 30 languages on the website right now. So if you know people in other countries, you could, you know, send them the link and ask them to join us. We also have a Prayer Circle for Animals Facebook that I send a prayer every week to that, or post it on that Facebook. Just like this coming week will be a memorial for Tillicum, the whale who died at SeaWorld. But the prayer itself, let's all take a deep breath and still our minds. And the prayer is very simple. Compassion encircles the earth for all beings everywhere. And just see that and feel that. And know that that is true. Thanks.
Well, thank you so much, Judy, for leading us in that prayer. And I think the simplicity of it is really what makes it universal, and it's something that we can all bring into our daily lives. I put the Circle of Compassion website on the chat box. If anybody wants to copy the chat box, you're to do that before we close out today. And I also want to take a moment to thank John so much for joining us and for sharing all about what you do. You're such an incredible inspiration. I'm really going to look deeper inside myself and also look towards other altruistic activities to do. It's just wonderful how you take all these opportunities to heart. And it's very inspiring.
It sure is, JP. Thank you so much. Oh, thank you. It's been wonderful.
And thanks to everyone for joining us, because this is what we're here for. We're a community, and we want to reach out and connect with you so that we know that we're not alone on our vegan journey. We're part of a circle of compassion that's really even beyond the group here tonight. It's going to keep spreading. And so it's really because of all of us taking the time to connect today. And we hope that you'll join us next month. Actually, we have Frank Lane, who's a guest on our, he's visiting with us today. He's one of the participants, and he's going to be sharing about the Great Compassion, which is a march that he's going to put together. And he'll talk more about that. The march is scheduled for next September, but we want to give everyone a heads up about it. So that will be our next gathering in the next month. It's always the second Thursday of the month. And I also want to just mention that we're doing our activist support group is coming up in 2 weeks on the 26th of this month. And to celebrate Activist Appreciation Month, which is February, for In Defense of Animals, we're going to be hosting an online conference. It's called Hope for Animals, and it's a summit that we're going to put together with all sorts of speakers. Everything's free, and we just want to put out the message of hope for the animals and for all of us. So I hope you can join us. Stay tuned. You'll hear more about that on our events page and on our e-news and other things like that. So the events page is idausa.org/events/. So it's with all that good news that we'll leave each other. But if anybody here wants to do a group goodbye, it's our tradition. If you'd like to just turn on your webcam or turn your audio on so we can all say goodbye to each other together. And I hope everyone has a wonderful evening. I look forward to reconnecting again soon.
Bye.
Bye.
Goodbye.
Bye-bye.